Good morning, everybody. I just need to check that everybody has communion elements. Has everybody got? If you don't have, put your hand up and the steward will bring to you. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this morning's worship service. I need to say, and I keep forgetting this, but when we have communion, our children and our teenagers join us, and then we don't have enough chairs. Isn't that an awesome thing? I think it's a phenomenal thing. I think it is really, really great not to have enough chairs in a church. It just means that God is moving and God is working. And we praise the Lord for that. Shall we pray together? Gracious Lord, we come together this morning to worship you, to acknowledge you, to praise you. As we do that, we are mindful that you are a God that is present in our lives, that you are a God that works within us, and that as community, we meet together to worship you, to praise you, and to exalt you. And so, Lord God, we pray for the empowering of your Holy Spirit upon us, that we may experience your move, the move of your Holy Spirit within us. Bless our time of worship together. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 48. I'm going to take these off. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. In the city of our God, his holy mountain. It is beautiful in its loftiness, the joy of the whole earth, like the utmost heights of Zaphron in Mount Zion, the city of the great king. God is in her citadels. He has shown himself to be her fortress. When the kings joined forces, when they advanced together, they saw her and were astounded. They fled in terror. Trembling seized them there, pain like that of a woman in labor. You destroyed them like ships of Tarshish, shattered by an east wind. As we have heard, so we have seen, in the city of the Lord Almighty, in the city of our God, God makes her secure forever. Within your temple, O God, we meditate on your unfailing love. Like your name, O God, your praise reaches to the ends of the earth. Your right hand is filled with righteousness. Mount Zion rejoices. The villages of Judah are glad because of your judgments. Walk with Zion. Go around her. Count her towers. Consider well her ramparts. View her citadels, that you may tell of them to the next generation. For this God is our God forever and ever. He will be our guide even to the end. Thanks be to God for his word. I'm going to invite you to stand together as we sing, Shine, Jesus, Shine. Amen. You may be seated. Now, I think Dimple is going to come and sleep. Just need to check that this mic's working for Dimple. Here we go.
Morning. Let's try that again. Good morning, everyone. How's everybody doing? Are we good? We good? Can everybody see me? Can everybody hear me? That's great. That's awesome. Who knows what this is? No, it's not. It's not a pillow. It's a bed. It's a bed. It's a pillow. Yes, you're right. It's a pillow. What do we use a pillow for? Sleeping. Pillow fights. Yes. I'm not going to lie. I tried to start some pillow fights outside. Nobody was keen, which is sad, but it's okay. Next time. So sleeping, pillow fights, yeah, maybe sometimes. Anything else? Tooth fairy. Yeah, the tooth fairy, to put your tooth underneath the... Yes, you're right, you're right. Yeah. Shh, don't talk about the tooth fairy. You got the tooth fairy. Oh, wow. You must bring the tooth fairy next time. You took it outside. Okay, set it free. Good. Yeah. Good. It's good that you set it free. Well done. Well done. So we use the pillow for our heads, to put our heads on when we sleep. And also for our necks, right? It brings us comfort. It helps us to sleep at ease. Have you guys ever tried sleeping without a pillow? Yes. How does it feel? It's nice. Okay, Leanne says it's nice. Last night she slept with a pillow. I've tried sleeping without a pillow. It is paining. It is terrible. Okay, you wake up and your neck is sore, your head is sore, your muscles are just not for you. Can I have your head and your neck? Oh, okay, next time. And your back. What about your back? Oh, your back is also paining. And Aina, right? So a pillow gives us comfort. It helps us to sleep in peace, right? It helps us to sleep in peace. But sometimes even a pillow can't help. So what kind of things also keep us up at night? I don't know. Worries? Yeah, maybe you're worried about your cat or your dog. Mosquitoes, South Africa, yes. You're worried about mosquitoes. Anything else? Stress, life in general, anxious. What are you going to have for school tomorrow? Are you going to sleep very nicely tonight? So many things bring us stress and anxiety and worry us, right? And then we lose our sleep, and then we don't get our proper sleep. It's important to have sleep and rest, more importantly, to rest for a long time, not a long time, okay, for enough time so that our bodies can rejuvenate and have enough energy in the morning and enough everything so that we can go about our day, right? But sometimes we are also tired spiritually, yeah? And what does Jesus say about that? Does anybody know? When you're tired, when you're just like, oh, I don't want to go to church today. Ugh, I don't want to carry on. What does Jesus? Rest in me. You say that, rest in me. Nice. Come and rest. Okay, nice. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, Jesus says, come to me, all of you who are tired and have heavy loads. I will give you rest. So Jesus gives us rest and comfort, right? To those who love him and to those who follow him. And we can rest easy, knowing that we will spend eternity with God in heaven. We'll never be tired, never be stressed, never be worried. We won't have to be like, oh, I can't sleep tonight because I'm stressing about tomorrow. I'm stressing about that test. I'm stressing about that friend. We won't have to worry about that, right? But even today, Jesus gives us rest and Jesus gives us comfort. And so we need to remember that. And so this week, I want you guys to remember a simple verse. Well, a simple line, okay? It's only four words. It's rest in the Lord. Can you guys remember that? Rest in the Lord. Okay, let's see if you guys can remember it. You guys have to say it with me, okay? Rest in the Lord. Okay, a bit louder. Rest in the Lord. I don't think the people online can hear you. Rest in the Lord. How about we do a squeaky voice? Do you guys remember your squeaky voices? Yes, exactly. Okay, let's try the squeaky voice. Rest in the Lord. Okay, now you will not forget it, yes? So whenever you go to bed, you remember, I'm not just resting my body, but I'm resting in the Lord. Awesome. Let us pray. And so we thank you, Lord God, that we can rest in you, that we can put our worries and all our stresses and all our anxieties to you, Lord, that we can just find rest in you. We thank you that you bring us comfort and that whenever we are worried about anything, that we can know that we can come to you, Lord. And so help us to rest. Help us to be filled with energy to go on each day. Help us to be active and to rely on you. And help us, Lord, to rest in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So I hope you guys all got a good rest tonight, yes? I didn't so much, so I'm relying on you guys. So we're all going to stand up, and we're going to sing our children's song next. I'm going to ask Lara and, I don't know, yeah, the youth who know the song to come up. So we're going to sing the next song.
You are our love. You are our peace. That without you leading us, guiding us, empowering us, we would be lost. And so, Lord God, we worship you, we praise you, we acknowledge you. And as we do that today, we also acknowledge that we are sinners, that we have sinned against you and sinned against each other. That there have been moments where we have thought things that have not made you happy, where we have said things that have hurt you and hurt others. And then, Lord, when we have done things, or even not done things that we should have done, that have hurt others. And so, Lord God, we want to acknowledge our brokenness. We want to acknowledge our sinfulness. And we want to acknowledge that, Lord God, you are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. And it is purely because of what you have done for us that we are able to come and confess our sins to you. And so, Lord God, hear our prayers in the moment of silence as we lift up our confessions to you. Jesus Christ, we give you thanks, honor, and praise. As scripture tells us, everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And so, Lord, as we have confessed our sins, we thank you that you are a just and faithful God, and that you will forgive us and purify us from all unrighteousness. And so may we hear the words of the risen Lord Jesus Christ as he says to each of us today, you are forgiven. As forgiven sinners, Lord God, we worship you. We praise you. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit that leads us and guides us. We thank you that we are not alone in this world, but that we form part of the body of Christ, a community of faith that share together, that worship together, that work alongside each other together. And Lord, there are often moments where we are uncertain of what to do. And it is through the power of your Holy Spirit that we are guided and led to do certain things. And so, Lord, we are reminded of your disciples that they asked you, Lord, how do we pray? And you taught them a prayer that we now say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We are now going to share in Holy Communion. And so I just need to check that everybody has a little communion cup. Does everybody have? Everybody's got. Hey, Linda? Anybody missing in front? Everybody got. All right. And so we are reminded that this is indeed a sacred moment, a moment in which we are reminded of the death of Jesus Christ. We are reminded of his sacrifice for us. But it is a moment of celebration as we celebrate that through Jesus' death and resurrection, he has won for us a victory over sin, evil, and death. And that when we share this meal, we are reminded of that gift. We are reminded of the salvation that is offered to us all. And so I'm going to invite you to peel off the plastic sleeve. If you need help, we have trained staff that are very helpful and are willing to assist you. If you need help, just put up your hand and they will come and assist you. Here we go, Laura. Anybody else needing help? And so I'm going to be reading the words written in 1 Corinthians 11, where Paul writes to the church and reminds them about the special meal. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Thanks be to God for his word. Shall we pray? Gracious Lord, as we offer these gifts to you, we acknowledge your power. We acknowledge your love for us, poured out through your Son, Jesus Christ. And so, Lord God, today we ask that you pour out your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, making them for us to be the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, that as we partake in Christ's suffering, in Christ's resurrection, and in Christ's victory. Bless this meal to us and bless us to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And so I invite you to take your wafer. You may remove your mask for a moment. Take, eat, and celebrate Christ our Lord. And then I'll invite you to peel back the aluminium foil. Once again, if you need assistance, please let us know. Anybody need assistance? We take the cup of the new covenant made in the blood of Jesus Christ. Take, drink, and celebrate Christ our Lord. You're welcome to put the little cups under your chair for now. There is a dustbin outside that when we leave, we can put them inside there. Shall we pray? Lord God, we thank you for this meal, a holy sacrament, a blessing to each and every one of us, a reminder of your love and your mercy offered to all of humanity. And so, Lord God, we do ask and we thank you for this blessing. We ask further that as we continue in our worship, as we continue in living out our lives, that we would hold on to this and share it with others. Bless us, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Our children and our youth are going to be making a bit of noise as they depart and go to their Sunday school. You may follow Dimple, you may follow Lara, Asanda, Odette. Here we go. I just want you to notice that as the children and our teenagers leave, the church has just got empty. I think that is phenomenal. I look forward to the day where there's more children than adults, because then there's more work for me, I think. No, less work. More work for Dimple and Lara and the Sunday school teachers. What a blessing it is to have the children share with us. I think it is truly, truly phenomenal. A couple of notices that I need to share with you this morning. Just a reminder, please, your phones on silent, because if they do ring, we will all look at you. You might be embarrassed, but we're not going to be embarrassed because it's not our phone. And then just a reminder, with COVID regulations, you need to keep your mask on, covering your nose as well as your mouth, unless you're up here, and then you can drop your mask. The flowers today are from Martin and children and their families. In loving memory of Maureen Fanikak, you're still sadly missed after 15 long years. Then Wednesday mornings, 10 a.m., we have our liturgical communion service. And so if you'd like to join us here in the sanctuary, 10 a.m. on a Wednesday morning, we have our liturgical service. Our 9:30 service is live streamed. And so if you do miss a service on a Sunday morning, you are most welcome to catch it live on the YouTube channel. It is then saved on the YouTube channel, and you can then watch it later on through the week as well. The 7:45 service, they are looking for some greeters, some door stewards. If you know anybody that might want to make themselves available to greet people at the door, to be friendly and smile. Did our door stewards do that this morning? Yes, okay, I was just checking. That's what you've got to do, smile and be friendly. So we are looking for the 7:45 service, some more door stewards. And then just a reminder, with us doing our renovations, we are selling off some of our church pews. The five-seaters are going for 500 Rand for a five-seater. If you take two, it's 999 Rand. If you take three, it's 1,498 Rand. I think my math is correct. So please, we've already sold, I think, 10 or 11. So please, if you are interested, phone the church office. Then our jumble sale team would like to extend a heartfelt, huge, big thank you to everybody. I think this Thursday they made just over 6,000. I should put my glasses on, then I can see the numbers at the back. Just over 6,000 Rand. Once again, this is a fundraiser for the church. The clothes that do not get sold, we then gift to other charities, other people in need. And so I just want to say thank you once again. The jumble sale money goes towards the maintenance of the church and upgrading of our church. And so thank you very much. We're not going to have one in December. We're not going to have one in January because everybody's broke. But we will start asking for donations in January towards the February jumble sale. But once again, thank you very much for everybody, for your assistance, for your donations. Next week, Sunday, we have a 7:45 service and a 9:30 service. Both are Remembrance Day celebrations. So if you have a military uniform and you want to put that on, you're most welcome to. If you have any medals, your own medals, you're welcome to put that on. If you have family members, medals. You are welcome to wear those as well. If you have a poppy, you're welcome to wear that. Otherwise, we will have little red poppies available next week, Sunday. Please do come and share. This is a celebration service as we remember our fallen soldiers. Then the 22nd of November, Queenswood Home, they're having their mini Christmas market. Please support them, 9 a.m. to 12 noon. If you'd like to have a table there, you need to contact Cheryl at the Queenswood Home, and the tables are available at 120 Rand each. Then for our youngsters, now that they've all left, Laura and Dimple will be speaking to them, but for our adults and grandparents, we are taking part in the Scripture Union Camp that is happening from the 17th to the 19th of December out in the Magaliesburg. It is for grades 4 to 7. The juniors are on one side of the campsite, and then grades 8 to 12, the seniors are on the other side of the campsite. It is a great amount of fun, and if you haven't done Christmas shopping yet and you need some peace, send them on the camp. And then just when they come back and you think, now what am I going to do with them? Laura and Dimple, they are busy organizing a holiday club here at the church, and so that's happening from the 21st to the 23rd, and that's for grades 1 through to grade 7. They're welcome to come and assist us. And then if the high schoolers, they're welcome to become leaders for that as well. All right. Any birthday celebrations? Anybody celebrating a birthday? Linda? The 30th, and that's 30 years old. 60. 30 times 2. My math is great today. I'm doing really well. All right. Congratulations. Oh, we've got another one. Simon, and it was? Tomorrow. Awesome. Congratulations. Anybody else? Going once, going twice. So between the two of you, 102 years. So I'm going to divide it and say, you've just lost some age. You're only 51. Simon, I feel sorry for you, though. Well, may the year ahead be a blessed year for both of you. Congratulations. Any wedding anniversaries? Nope. Any good news? Amen. That's great news. So, Mrs. Dixon was just sharing. Lynn, a friend of them, has been admitted to hospital with her oxygen levels being low, but they've come up, they're stable, she's in hospital, and so he's going to be getting the care that she needs, and then you received a job. So you're blessed. And that's not just looking after your husband. No, it's a more easier job. Okay. All right. Any other good news? Clive? I was going to be facetious and say that was a miracle, but I will not say that. I will just think it all by myself. All right. I saw another hand. Linda? Okay, so just for our online viewers, Linda went down to Cape Town, saw her grandson, and just the blessing of being able to share time there. Reg? That's always a good thing. Amen. Amen. Here we go. So just for the online viewers, it doesn't go through the mic, so I need to repeat. Thursday with the jumble sale, we had new people, new ladies come. And they, what a blessing, because they were able to buy so much, even had to go and draw money. And Reg and them were able to help the one take her bags of clothing down to the taxi rank, and then met the other one there and brought her back here to pay for the purchases that she had made. Jean shared with me earlier. Can I share now? Jean shared with me earlier that they've been praying for her daughter Dale, that hasn't been doing very well, has struggled with an ulcer for quite some time, had a gastrointestinal, and then a colonoscopy. I got that one right. I was going to struggle with that one, I thought. And the test results came back all clear. And they've been praying that it would come back all clear. And so just, Reg, you said it, God turns situations around. And so once again, through prayer, miracles happen. God turns situations around, and we just give God the honor and the glory for that. Amen. Shall we pray? Lord God, we thank you that you're a God that hears our prayers, that answers our prayers, and today we're able to give you the honor and the glory and say thank you, Jesus. Thank you for healing. Thank you for restoration. Thank you for the blessings, Lord. Thank you for birthdays. Lord, we acknowledge that we are truly blessed, and so we just continue to pray for your hand upon us, upon our loved ones, upon our families, and we worship you. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. I'm going to invite you to remain seated as we sing together, Be Still for the Presence of the Lord.
Of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Come bow before Him now with reverence and fear. He burns with holy.
And then we have sound, and then we don't have sound. Now we've got sound. I don't know where you live, but in Doornkloof, we get it quite often. And the fear that we have is that when the power does come on, the power doesn't come on. Because at night when the power goes off, there are people that believe that is the time to come and collect the cables that are hanging and aren't doing anything. Because clearly they're not doing anything, there's no power on them. And so we often wake up and then there's another power outage, and it's because someone has come and stolen the electrical cables while we have been in load shedding. And so I want to say today, and it's not something new, that the power source in South Africa is not reliable. Not like our spiritual power source that is the Holy Spirit. For Christians, the Holy Spirit provides us power for our spiritual lives. The Holy Spirit wants to empower us, to fill us, to allow us to continue the mission of God. The mission of God where we are called to be disciples, to make disciples to the very ends of the earth. And so today we're going to look at Acts chapter 2, and I'm going to be reading just the first four verses. Acts chapter 2, reading from verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with awe, were filled with the Holy Spirit, and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Just so far in God's word. When I read this in preparation for today, my first thought was, who is the they that Luke is writing about? Because he writes, when the day of Pentecost came, they were all together. Who is, was they? If we go a little bit earlier in Acts, we read Acts chapter 1, verse 2, until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit, the apostles he had chosen. And so who were the apostles? We know who they were. Peter, John, James. They were the core. But there were more. There was actually 12, but at this time there weren't any 12, only 12, because Judas had fallen by the wayside. So there was 11. So is it these 11, now called apostles, that were in the house when the Holy Spirit came upon them? Further in Acts chapter 1, Luke writes that they, the 11, are joined. And I'm going to read at verse 14 of chapter 1. They all joined together and constantly in prayer along with the woman and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. So if we're saying that they are the 11, yeah, they're worshiping together, but they then joined by the woman. Which woman? Mary, Martha, Elizabeth, Magdalene? How many other women were there? I believe it is the woman that supported Jesus' ministry and supported the disciples in the work that they were doing. So I can't tell you how many women, but there were more women. So no longer is it just 11, because then Mary, the mother of Jesus, joins as well. And then Jesus' brothers join. So now we're probably up to what, 20? But it doesn't end there. Verse 15, in those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120. So no longer 11, no longer 15, 16, 17, up to more than 120 believers had gathered with the apostles, with a woman, with Jesus' mother, with his brothers. There was a group of believers that had come together to worship together, to learn together, to study together, to be encouraged, because can you remember the 11 had locked themselves up in a room for fear of the Jews, and now the group is growing. Steadily, those that had followed Jesus, those that were in the crowds, were now coming together, maybe to support the 11, because they were the close ones to Jesus. Maybe to support Mary and his brothers. But now there's more than 120 believers that have come together. Now, I need to say there's many views on how many were in the upper room. But I want to suggest that there was a crowd of people, a crowd of believers in that room that had gathered on the day of Pentecost, those who truly believed in Jesus Christ. And I want to say that is the key to receiving the power of the Holy Spirit. Those who truly believe shall receive the Holy Spirit. The Spirit that came to rest upon each of them makes me think about Jesus' baptism. Do you recall the story? It's in Matthew 3. Jesus gets baptized, and then a dove descends, enlightening upon him. Just like the Holy Spirit comes as a fire and separates and lights upon each one of them, so the Holy Spirit descended like a dove and lighted upon Jesus Christ. And so I want to suggest today that it is one and the same Spirit, that there is no other Spirit, but it is the Spirit of God, the same Spirit that speaks to Jesus, that blesses Jesus, that comes now to Jerusalem, to this house, to this upper room, because the disciples were told in the Great Commission, go and wait in Jerusalem so that you will receive the power from on high, the power that has been promised to you. And so they are waiting. And it wasn't just the 11. A crowd had gathered. The Holy Spirit is part of God, a triune God. Triune means basically three persona: Father God, Holy Spirit, and Son. And so you've got the three, and we've often try and define and try and allow people to understand how can it be. And there's different analogies about water being liquid, but in vapor it's still water, in ice it's still water. God as three persona, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, still remains God. It's the same as I am Charlie, the husband of Louise. I am Charlie, the father of Gabriel and Jada. I am Charlie, the son of Val and Ray. But I'm still Charlie. Just in different circumstances, different situations, I play a different role. And so if we look through the whole entire book, God's history, God's story, we see God in the Old Testament more as Father God, the disciplinarian. But if we look carefully, it is God that loves, that disciplines. We are introduced to Jesus more so in the Gospels about Jesus being the Son of God, but still fully God. And then we get introduced now to the Holy Spirit. And some people say, but we don't hear about it anywhere else. I want to say, go look at Genesis. In the beginning, when God created, God spoke the word. If you're reading John's gospel, John writes, the word became flesh. Jesus Christ became flesh. So in the beginning, in creation, Jesus is there because Jesus is the word. When God spoke, it happened. God created through Jesus Christ. God was there and God saw. And so God Father is there. Jesus is there. The Word is there. And then if you read, it says, the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the deep. All three persona, roles of God are evident in the creation story. But in different areas of the Bible, we see different parts of God more prominent. But it is still one God. But back to the Holy Spirit. It was the Holy Spirit that gave the disciples the ability to speak in different tongues on the day of Pentecost. The Holy Spirit that came upon the believers that were gathered there. It is this Holy Spirit that dwells within us, that dwells within you, that dwells within me when we accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of our lives. It is this Holy Spirit that produces fruit in us. And I'm not speaking about bananas and pears. I'm speaking about love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and probably the one I struggle most with, self-control. It is the Holy Spirit that allows us to produce the fruit of the Spirit. It is the Holy Spirit that gifts us with certain abilities, talents. Some are gifted to preach. Some are gifted to teach. Some are gifted with the ability to create craftsmanship. Some are given the gift of prophecy and interpretation, discernment, wisdom. But when we as the body of Christ gather together, we have all those gifts in our midst. And that is why God calls us a community, the body of Christ. Sometimes I think it would be great to have all of the gifts of the Spirit. But then I'm like, but then I'd want to do everything myself. And if I've learned anything in life, I cannot. I try, and I often fall short when I try it by myself. We are called as a community of faith to support each other. And so those that are able to operate a computer and put words on you, that is their gift. That is their gift to the greater church. Those that are able to offer their gift in sound or operating online stuff, that is their gift. Some people are gifted at greeting people at the door. Other people are gifted in preaching and teaching. Every one of us has a gift. And when we come together as the body of Christ, we are empowering the church of God to do the work that God has called us to do. The disciples had to wait for the Holy Spirit. You and I do not need to wait, because the moment we acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of our lives, we are gifted with the Holy Spirit. We are made aware of the Holy Spirit, and we are empowered by the Holy Spirit to go and make disciples. So what? Right? So what? You and I are gifted by, and we are empowered by the Holy Spirit. But I want to say it doesn't just stop there. There is something that you and I need to do. And I want to suggest the best is to follow Scripture. And so we're going to look at Acts 2, verse 42, a well-known Scripture that speaks about fellowship, that speaks about community, that speaks about the empowering of the Holy Spirit. And when we allow the Holy Spirit to empower us, what happens? Hear this. This is what happens. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. You hear that? The first thing they did, they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. We need to be taught. We need to continually learn. We need to study God's word so that we can grow closer to God, so that we can become more in tune with the promptings of the Holy Spirit. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. I'm going to pause there again. In John 15, Jesus says to the disciples, "You will do even greater things than these." He was speaking about his miracles, his healings, and he says to the apostles, "You will do even greater things than these." And so when Jean says, as a family, they were praying for Dale for healing, "We will do even greater things." And she received that healing by the power of the Holy Spirit. Greater things. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to everyone as he had need. Every day, they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Thanks be to God for his word. So let's just go back a bit. We've got the 11 apostles. They joined by the woman. They joined by Mary. They joined by Jesus' brothers. They then joined by about 120 believers. That's in Acts 2. We've read it. Day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit comes upon them. Peter preaches the first sermon he's ever preached in his life, and 3,000 come to know Christ that day. What a preacher. It wasn't Peter. The power of the Holy Spirit used Peter to draw 3,000 and add it to their number. And if we read in Acts 42, verse 42, they met daily in the temple courts. So that's the outer courts. 3,000 of them met together with the 120, with the 15 or 20 others. They gathered together. Now, what happens when crowds gather together? We're inquisitive. We want to know what's happening. And so guess what happens? People start to stand on the peripheral and says, "Shirley, what's happening? What's happening there? Sean, I can't see. Tell me. Barbara, what's happening? Linda, what's happening?" And so Sean and Barbara and Linda start to talk about what's been happening. And guess what? Daily, the Lord added to their number those that were being saved. It started off 11. A couple days later, a couple months later, they're over 3,000. And they're continuing to meet together as the body of Christ, being empowered by the Holy Spirit to share. Now, not everybody can stand up front and preach. Not everybody can stand up front and talk. But you know what you can do? Is share what God has done in your life. Share the power that has been imparted to you through the Holy Spirit. They enjoy the favor of all the people, and God added to their number. You and I are called by God. You and I are empowered by God through the Holy Spirit. And you and I are empowered by God to fulfill the mission of God. What are you and I supposed to do? If we look at verses 42 onwards, meet together, share together, pray together, meeting the needs of those around us, praising God together and devoting ourselves to studying God's word. We do this because we are equipped and we are empowered by God, not in our strength, but in the strength of God. And so I want to challenge you, I want to encourage you to allow the Holy Spirit to empower you. You don't need to be afraid. God's not going to do stuff with you that you won't want to do or don't want to do. I've always wanted to be up front in front of people and not be afraid. I've always wanted to have that experience. Growing up, I was terrified. And I need to be honest, I'm still terrified when I stand up in front of you because you guys are scary. That's not very nice. But you know what allows me to do this? Is the power of the Holy Spirit. God wants to empower you. God wants to fill you. God wants to use you. But God cannot force you to do that. You've got to be open. And so my prayer is that we'd be open to the move of the Holy Spirit within our lives. Shall we pray together? Lord God, we thank you that when Jesus ascended, he promised the Holy Spirit. And yes, the disciples needed to wait, but we do not need to wait because your Holy Spirit dwells within us. And so, Lord, make us more mindful, more aware of your Holy Spirit, so that when we are prompted, we may respond. Pour out your Spirit upon us, strengthen us, encourage us, build us, Lord, so that we may honor you and glorify you. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And so I'm going to invite us to stand together as we are led in worship, Holy Spirit by Jesus Culture.
There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be
Amen. Amen. Now an opportunity for us to share in intercessory prayers, and if there are any prayer needs, if you'd like to share them with me now. Any prayer needs? Rain?
Another alternative. So it's going to have a whole year of chemo, and we pray
Amen. Okay, so we're going to be praying for Bernard, cancer of the bladder, and we're just praying that the chemo that is chosen will work and that God would use that to bring about healing and restoration. Anybody else? Maria? Peace. Okay. Amen. We will pray for peace in the world. Amen. Thank you, Maria. We will definitely be praying for more peace in the world. Anybody else? Ria? Rina? Okay. So, Annalise has been worshiping here. She's got two boys, and their dad or her husband is in New Zealand, has been there for 2 years already. And so they're in the country trying to get visas, and we just need to be praying for visas for them to get across to New Zealand. Ezekiel? Amen. Thank you. And so we had shared about the elections and asked God for peaceful elections, free and fair. And so I need to say for the large part, for the most part, that was the case. All right. Shall we pray? Father God, we thank you that you are the God that heals and restores. We continue to pray for Lynn and her condition and just ask for your healing upon her. We thank you that Dale has received your healing and continue to pray for total healing and restoration. We thank you that Mrs. Dixon has received a job and is able to do that job and in that job just bring you honor and glory. Father God, we pray for Bernard at this moment as he's chosen to go for further treatment for the cancer of the bladder, and we just ask, Lord, that this is the right decision, that you would bring healing and restoration to his body. Father God, we continue to pray for peace in our land and peace around the world, that people would experience your love and the outpouring of your Holy Spirit upon them, and that they would come to know your peace and your love. And so may there be peace in our world, Lord. We continue to pray for Annalise and for the boys, just asking, Lord, that you would make it possible for them to be granted their visas to go over to be reunited with husband and father. May that happen, Lord God. We thank you for the little bit of rain that we've had, and we continue to pray for more rain, that you may pour out your rain upon our lands, filling our rivers, our streams, our lakes, our dams, our water catchment areas, Father God. We thank you for the elections that happened fairly smoothly. We know and acknowledge there were hiccups, but we just pray and we thank you that, Lord, our main prayer was for peace in our land and that we experienced. We pray, Father God, that those that have been elected in different wards and councils will govern, will lead your people, that they will not just be in it for themselves, but that they'll be in it to serve your people. Lord, continue to raise up Christian leaders to lead. We ask that you bless us, bless our families, bless our loved ones. And as we do give a retiring offering, we just ask your blessing upon those gifts, that indeed they may be used to further your kingdom, to fulfill the mission of God. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to invite us to stand together as we say the benediction. We reach out our hands to those close to us and we say together, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. Shalom, the peace of the Lord be with you. Amen.